Welcome, we'll start with NCERT class 8, the 7th chapter that talks about weavers, iron smelters and factory owners. Now, as we know, during the time of industrial revolution, the scenario in India was very different. What was happening actually during that time was, the raw material was supplied to Britain and Britain in turn was providing the finished products to India. Later on, the things became so that the finished product that was coming to India was much cheaper as compared to what was produced in India. And slowly and gradually, there was a need to kind of put a voice against the imports that were coming up. And therefore, you had the Mahatma Gandhi's movement that took place. So, we would study about all that in detail as we move forward. So, let's understand what was the major trading scenario during that time. During the 17th century, Surat was one of the major trading centers. However, its importance slowly and gradually declined during the 18th century. Same was the case with Machilipatnam and so on. The two major craft industries which were predominant during the Industrial Revolution period was, first, the cotton textile and second, the iron and steel. So, cotton textile, much of the mechanized production was coming from Britain during the 19th century and iron and steel was growing from 1850s, and slowly and gradually Britain was called as the workshop of the world because they were the whole and soul people who were producing or who were actually manufacturing the goods during that time. During the late 18th century, company was buying the goods from India and selling the finished product to India. So, it was gaining up huge profits, and these huge profits were amounting for the poverty situations in India, and a lot of finished products or manufactured products were flooded into the Indian markets. If we talk about the Indian textile, around 1750, before the Britishers conquered the region of Bengal, India was considered as the largest producer of cotton textiles in the world. It was known for quality production, it was known for fabrication, and it was known for the fine craftsmanship during that time. And many of the cotton textile was traded to West and Central Asia and Southeast Asia. So, most of our trading was confined to in Asian region itself. Now, some of the good kinds of cotton textiles or the textile industries, first of all was Patola, which was woven in Surat, Ahmedabad and Patan region of Gujarat. It was highly valued in the region of Indonesia. The next important was muslin, which was malmal. It was a kind of very fine cotton cloth from India, which was used mainly by the Arab traders in Iraq. The next was calico. Now, calico was a cotton textile coming from Calicut in Kerala, and this was valued by Portuguese. Again, you had a huge order that was placed in 1730, and this order accounted to nearly 6 lakh pieces of cloth, and that was from nearly 98 cotton varieties and silk varieties that were woven in India. So, during that time, India's position was a kind of predominant position in the world for cotton and textile. There were other printed clothes that were common, that was chintz. These were the flowery designs that were seen. Then you have koases or khasa. You had bandhana, those were the scarves, and later on, previously those were the tie and dye in Rajasthan and Gujarat. The next was jamdani art, which was common in the loom workers. It was mainly in grey and white color and was popularly done in the areas of Dhaka and Lucknow. So, you had the jamdani work that was common. The other areas which were producing textile were Kasim Bazar, Patna, Calcutta, Odisha and Charpur. So, what was the thing was, during the 18th century, Europeans were very afraid of the popularity of the cotton textiles from India. So, there was a kind of ban on chintz, that was the flowery design in England, and this act was known as Calico Act. The sole idea was to protect their own workers. So, England started the production for growing the, for manufacturing the cotton textile. As a result, you had the calico printing industry that was established in England, and it used the Indian cloth, which was basically the malmal or the unbleached Indian cloth, and you had the same designs that were replicated from India by the England. During that time, there was 1764 spinning jenny, and you had the steam engine that was invented. Steam engine revolutionized the weaving industry, and spinning jenny was a wheel which could rotate many spindles at a given time. So only one person was required to rotate many of the spindles. As a result, the productivity was much higher than the traditional spindles. So these two inventions brought a kind of winning edge for the Britain cotton textile industries. So they started producing more and more during that time. However, India's textile industry still dominated. There were two major reasons for it. First was the traditional art that the Indians could do, and second was the border printing that the Indians could do, and these two could be done only by hand. Machines could not replace it. So therefore, Indian textile still dominated during that time, but slowly and gradually these things were kind of vanishing off, and some of the weavers that were predominantly belonging to different areas of India were slowly and gradually vanishing out. So from Bengal you had the Tanti weavers, in North India you had the Julahas or Momins, in South India you had the Sail, Kalikokar and Devangs, and all these were passing the skills from one generation to the next and so forth. During that time, spinning was mainly done by the females. So it was spun on the charka and then rolled on takli. So those two were the basic equipments in the traditional textile industry that were used in India. Then you had rangis, those were the people who were dyeing the cloth, and chipkars, those were the people who were putting up the block prints. So you had a kind of block prints of different, let's say, birds or animals, and these blocks were printed onto the cloth, and those were known as chipkars. So, but besides all these, there was a kind of decline in the Indian textile industry in the later period that was witnessed. Some of the major reasons which attributed to that were, first, the cloth that was coming up from Britain was much cheaper because of the Industrial Revolution in Britain. The exports from India was much difficult because of the higher taxation. The European market was not open to the finished product of India. The English goods were more popular in India, and the worst hit area was the region of Bengal, which provided maximum employment to the cotton textile industry. Many of the British cloth was coming to India. Nearly 2/3 of the cloth that was worn by Indians was produced in Britain. Many of the warehouses that was common during that time, which were named as orangs, were slowly and gradually abolished. But despite of that, as we said, Indian textile industry survived because of some of the works that were predominantly reserved for hand woven industry or the traditional handprints. And again, the coarse cloth that was worn by the poor, that could not be brought up from Britain at such a cheap price. So these two areas were the areas where Indian textile industry still survived. And during the late 19th century, you had Solapur in West India and Madura in South India, which became the major textile centers. Mahatma Gandhi boycotted the foreign products and foreign goods, and charkha was considered as the center of the tricolor flag of the Indian National Congress in 1931. So many of the weavers who lost job because of the lack in the employment in textile industry moved on as agricultural laborers. Some of those also migrated to other nations like Africa and South America. However, after Gandhi's efforts, there were new mills coming up in India. So there was mills established in Ahmedabad, Kanpur, Mumbai. The first mill was established in Mumbai, and it could export raw cotton. And because of the black soil in that region, the later mills were established in the nearby areas where you had good growth of cotton that was seen. Again, the spurt came up during the First World War, when textile imports from the Britain suddenly declined because of the First World War, and Indian factories were asked to produce more cloth for the military needs. So during that time, the Indian textile again regained. The next was So this was about the cotton textile. Coming on to the iron and steel. Now we know sword of Tipu Sultan is well known, and this is still preserved or kept in the museum in England. Now this sword was made of wood steel, and this wood steel that time was very popular in South India. It basically had very sharp edges with a kind of flowing water pattern. So what was happening was small carbon crystals were embedded in the iron during the process of making it, and the angelicized version of this sword or the wood steel was known as Ukku in Canada, Hukku in Telugu and Urukku in Malayalam. So these were the different names that were known by. Again, this steel was made in the smelting furnaces, and in this furnace you had iron that was mixed with charcoal, and this was capped in the clay pots during that time and under a kind of controlled temperature. This was such an interesting case that Michael Faraday, who discovered electricity and electromagnetism, did a research for nearly 4 years on the properties of wood steel that India was manufacturing during that India manufactured during that time. So there was a specialized technique for the production and the smelting of iron and refining of iron. The smelting was predominantly done by the male members of the family, and bellowing, that was pumping of the air into the furnace for keeping the charcoal burning, that activity was done by the females of the family. But slowly and gradually, many of the furnace was abandoned. There were two reasons again for the same. First was, they were not allowed to bring in charcoal from the reserve forest areas. The second was, if they were allowed in some cases, the taxes were very high. So what happened was, the profit margin reduced significantly, and therefore, these smelters were no more interested in doing so. So later on, during the late 19th century, iron steel was slowly and gradually imported from Britain, and the demand of the local craftsmen declined. Now, how did iron steel plant was first established in India? In 1904, Charles Weld, who was an American geologist, along with Dorabji Tata, who was the eldest son of Jamshedji Tata, they travelled to the areas of Chhattisgarh, and they were looking for a region of a very fine iron ore. They saw numerous aggies carrying basket loads of iron and moving along. So communicating with them, they got to know that Rajhara Hills were having the finest iron ores in the world. Now they wanted to establish an iron ore plant in this region, but the sole problem was this region was very dry and water was a prerequisite for establishment of an iron and steel industry. So what they did was, they established iron and steel industries on the banks of river Subranekha, and this plant was known as Tisco, and Tisco, the city around that, was named after Jamshedji Tata, and this city was named as Jamshedpur. Established in 1912. During that time, the steel that was used was imported from Britain. You had the railways that were developed, and a numerous expansion took place during that time. During that time, after the establishment, First World War broke out. So what happened was, the British steel supplies were reserved for the wars. Again, whatever Tisco was producing was mainly the shells and the carriage wheels required for the war. During that time, by 1919, 90% of the steel that was brought by the colonial government was from India, and this Tata steel plant became one of the biggest steel industries within the British Empire. Later on, the demand further expanded and the government protection was required for further development. Now, during that time when industrialization was taking place in India, same period you had Japan witnessing industrial revolution. However, Japan was supporting the growth of industries in contrast to India, where the whole idea was expanding the markets for colonial goods. However, Japan was focusing on the development of the industries. So 1868 was the period of Meiji regime, and during that time, Japan was basically industrializing. Under the Western domination, there was postal service, telegraph, railways, steam shipping that was developed in Japan. You had large industries that were first established with the help of government, which slowly and gradually moved on to private ownership later on in Japan. However, in India, colonial domination was the basic barrier that prevented the growth of industrialization in India. So these were some of the key developments that were witnessed, and Japan's industrialization was important because the development of industries in Japan was linked to the needs of the military. So those were the two reasons why the industrialization in Japan was much different from the industrialization taking place in India during that time. So with this, we cover the 7th chapter. We'll be covering the further lectures in history. So stay tuned. Have a very good day ahead.